Greg Potter. Oh, okay, nice. I can say that's a Buddy Rich big band. I guess maybe there's people who played with Buddy Rich, but... maybe it's like a tribute Blackman, okay. Oh, she's gotten older. She was she is one of the fucking OG baddies back in the day. I like her Gretchkin. There she is. Still got those fast hands though. We'll be right back. Black was no joke. One of the OGs for a reason. Gets like that really nice like thumpy tone at that 18-inch bass drum too. This hi-hat sound really nice too, nice and dark. Yeah, dry. I don't like how sometimes they add these bands around them to like play shit, but they're playing like really basic shit that isn't, I don't know, I feel like it doesn't matter. It's just like background noise. That was kinda cool. What was that, a triplets off the ride? And the high top? She has like a really, I've always liked the way that she would take like basic rudiments or like fills and just use them by themselves. She's definitely got like that inner like kind of monologue going though of like the sound that she hears playing in her head. They have that sub kick on the bass drum. And I don't know if it needs it. I feel like it'd probably sound better if it was a little bit drier like the rest of the kit. But I guess maybe it helps.
Hey everybody,
for
Eric Lederman here, producer of Late Night with Seth Meyers. I created the Rotating Drummer Program. I was a drummer in a former life. I'm here today to talk about one of my favorite players. She's playing the Modern Drummer Festival this year. She's done it many times before, but she's an awesome player. She's been on the show 4 times. An incredible feel, very unique style playing. She can do anything, rock, fusion, jazz. I'm sure she can play metal and bust out 2 kicks. It's Nikki Glaspie. She's played with Beyoncé, Maceo Parker.
She's really good.
Now she's in Kamani.
If it's who I think it is, she's
over there
really
on
good.
Drums, doing the 2-drum thing. Really looking forward to seeing that. But she's a wonderful person. An incredible feel on the kit, and that's why she's done the show so many times, because she's a pro behind the kit and in life. Ladies and gentlemen, Nikki Glaspie.
Yeah, okay. It is. Got those gospel chops for days.
Thank you.
I always liked how, like, she has, like, a really heavy hand in play. She, like, wails the fuck out of her drums.
Evangelist Nikki Glassby on drums, y'all.
Any art.
Responsibility, discipline, and hard work, which are fundamentals to becoming successful. I was the worst, and I'm the guy just like a running back in football, just pounding and pounding and pounding and pounding. That hard work and persistence.
I don't know why drummers always do this.
Supported by passion and talent.
Drummers in particular have to like try to look really unique.
Is the key to success.
I don't know why. I've met so many drummers that wear scarves. I don't know what it is with drummers. It's fucking scarves. Someone who just talked so much shit about practicing to be the best, like he just did, wasn't that crazy. Oh, is it Stuart Copeland? Yep, Stuart Copeland. Stuart Copeland's actually so good. If anybody doesn't know who that is, that's Stuart Copeland from The Police. But I'm guessing this is like a side project of his. He likes to do like reggae shit. That was cool for a second there. He was hitting like the bell of his hi-hat for like different sound effects, and then like added those extra like little splashes on. Those really little splashes. I don't remember the last time I listened to like anything where Stuart Copeland was actually trying to do like reggae stuff. Funny, because even like before Sublime, like you could actually kind of credit Stuart Copeland with like really pushing like the first bits of like that like, white boy reggae. heisty cymbals. And I think he's using Atomic Kit, right? I think so. I think he uses Star Classic. Could be wrong. I don't remember it exactly. Pretty positive it is, though. I don't know what this guy's saying, but he's got the damn vocals down. That is Thomas Star Classic. Gotta love the Star Classics. Good about like placing those slams when he would like use those as like transitional fills. That was a cool fill. Wearing fucking Nike golf gloves. That's what it looks like. Thought he was saying Boli. That's cool how he like mixed it up to match the congas in that last one.
Looking back over my career, which is over the span of 64 years,
Danny Serafine,
I have so much to be thankful for, so many great memories, so much great music that I've been a part of. And all the way back to when I was 16, my first road gig backing up Chuck Berry, to the 23 years with Chicago and all those great albums and great musical moments. 1990, when I left Chicago, I quit playing for 15 years, which is a long time. I almost forgot. And one of the, in bringing me back to playing, one of the things that really galvanized that was the 2016 Modern Drummer Festival, where I was one of the featured drummers. And the feeling of the outpouring of respect and love I got from all the drummers in the world, so to speak, welcoming me back. You know, to today, where Modern Drummer released my book in its Legend series. It's the first drum book I've ever done. And, you know, it's a great combination of pictures and transcriptions. And I think it's the drummers will enjoy it. And that was a joy for me to do it. So sit back and relax and enjoy some of the greatest drummers in the world, the 2021
so
Modern Drummer.
Sit back and relax.
When you have the power of music within your soul, in your heart, nothing can stop you. Joey Jordison. Oh, RIP, man. That sucks.
Coming up after the break, a masterclass in drumming from some of the best in the world.
A
and
break,
we'll announce
bitch.
The winner
better
not. Of the Neil
Peart
Spirit of Drumming Scholarship. Later, exclusive performances, special guests, and the legendary Sheila E. makes history.
Sheila E.
We'll be back after this
queen.
Break.
Queen. The actual drumming queen. Like, there's Taylor Gordon, the pocket queen, and then there's Sheila E., just the overall drumming queen.
Greetings, drummers, from William F. Ludwig III. How's everybody doing?
Look at that snare drum behind him.
I just wanted to share a few thoughts on Modern Drummer with you all.
Oh, that's so sick.
I've been
that snare drum behind him was the one they based off of.
Since the very beginning.
I want to say it's the old Chevy vehicles.
And at that time, I was the artist relations for Ludwig Drum Company.
Those kits were sick. They're limited edition.
Over a weekend, I was going down my list of artists to choose a couple of people we would use for advertising for the following year. And I just said out loud, wow, I've really got a stable of stars here. And that thought just stuck with me. I couldn't get stable of stars off my mind all weekend. Presented the idea to the staff, which included my father and everyone else, Monday morning, of doing a group endorser
ad in
a horse stable and call it Ludwig Stable of Stars Doesn't Horse Around. And this was quite an undertaking and quite an event, including Ginger Baker, Ronnie Tutt, that was like 9 days after Elvis had passed away, Carmine and Vinnie Appice, many other famous, great, great rock drummers.
Look at all those
and
fucking porn star stashes.
It gave everybody a chance to get together and talk about what are you using, what snare drum, which stands, and really was beneficial for all of us to get that type of input. And believe it or not, it was a riot. We had quite a good time doing that photo. So much so I did 4 more after that over the years. But that ran in Modern Drummer's first issue, which was 1977, as a double spread ad, and really had a huge impact on the percussion world. And want to tell everybody, keep your eyes on Modern Drummer online in 2022 for their upcoming events. And I'm so happy to still be working with them with my own drum company, WFL3 Drums. And hope everybody will check that
out,
too.
Wait, did he branch off of Ludwig? What the fuck? Why would he do that? I'll have to look into that. WFL3 Drums.
Hi, this is Bobby Rondinelli. Welcome to the Modern Drummer Festival. I co-wrote a book with Michael Lorn called The Encyclopedia of Double Bass Drumming. There's a new version coming out. I wrote another 350 beats and fills, 5 new chapters, Be sure to check out new articles on Modern Drummer.
I'll be real. If you're not
on the website
Thomas
and in the magazine,
I'm probably
in the
not
future.
Buy a double
Hope to see you soon. Take
you.
Care.
Bye. Punch miss. Was that a bass drum? Oh, it's for the gong. Here we go.
Hey, this is Mike Sleep. Electronics are a huge part of modern music and modern drumming, and that's why I play Roland.
Chose a better sounding kit. Like, it's not horrible, but I guess that's the, what is that, the TD-30 or something? Or I don't even know what it's on now, the top one. I always thought, what is it, the TD-14 or the TD-9? Always had, like, the best sound. Don't fucking poison me. Here's a lot of experience that I would like to pass on to many drummers who would benefit from what I know.
Hi, Dom Famularo here. Modern Drummer is all about celebrating the greatest drummers while teaching this next generation. I am inspired and impressed by these future drummers. They are passionate, creative, and I make it a point to listen and learn from them. I want you to check this out.
That's kind of cool, but he does like content with like probably students and stuff. Like a little bit of style. Like, she's not doing anything crazy, but she's like, she's actually using like motifs and shit. It's so weird how he's playing his time. Like, all drummers make weird faces when they play, but hers are particularly interesting. She's having a good time, though.
That was a nice take.
Hi, everyone. Les DeMuro coming to you from my drum studio in Amelia Island, Florida. I'm so honored to once again be invited to participate in Modern Drummer Festival 2021. What a ball. I must tell you that in my teaching, I get a lot of students that are in the high school level wanting to bridge the gap between high school jazz bands and college jazz bands. Now, one of these tunes that I teach is Count Basie's hit, Shiny Stockings. I'm going to play just a little bit of that and how I would play the figures on that shout chorus.
Some of these
tunes. Shout chorus on Shiny Stocking goes, ba ba da ah ah. So once I get that the student to internalize that, now I also get them to scat sing that so that they really have the melody in their mind. Then we work on playing the figure and setting up the figure. So that shout would be like this. One, two, one, two, three.
Got a nice press roll. I wonder what they're filming this on. On the mouth, but I'm not sure those shells are Yamaha.
Hey, Rick Latham coming at you from my studio, the Boom Boom Room here in Columbia, South Carolina, as part of the Modern Drummer Festival 2021 online.
Yeah, doing a little online teaching today, and I wanted to show three licks that I actually get a lot of questions about. One is this triplet fill with followed by two bass drum strokes.
Get a lot of questions about it, huh?
And they're all like triplet 2/16 kind of ideas.
Yeah, you got a lot of questions about that, huh?
Second one is a triplet off of the floor tom. Again, triplet 2/16. And the third triplet-y lick, double lick that I like to use, is just triplets with the playing the last two triplets.
I'm not getting good Pokemon to like fight right now. No, he's not playing the Pornhub theme song.
I'm John Riley here at the Memphis Drum Shop, and ooh, I'd like Memphis. To share a couple of grooves that I included in this book some
look
years
that,
ago
that
was published by Modern
him.
Drummer Magazine.
Oh, on the side,
book
too.
Is
that
a collection
sick.
Of columns I'd written for them. And
that's real,
even
dope.
If you never use the groove, I think the process of getting comfortable with it will be beneficial. So this first one is based
on nice
what we call
and
the
shit.
Bembe
I'm willing to bet
rhythm,
the audio is going to be way better.
Which is 12/8 Afro-Cuban
rhythm.
Stop
with the gravelers.
And if my hi-hat plays quarter notes, then the right hand plays. So the second one, number 10, is a
oh, he's
little,
actually doing
just
a real Latin
little twist on that.
That shit's hard.
And
there's so many different variations and combinations.
That I hear in there that ties everything together that I try to orchestrate.
I have an old book that like
way.
They don't make anymore of like from the like 60s or 70s of like Latin grooves, and shit's real hard.
And I'm thinking one triplet, two triplet, three triplet, four triplet, one, two, three, four. And then add the bembe rhythm, the right hand part, which can be on the cymbal.
Swear to God, if I keep getting fucking gravel, I'm just gonna be so mad.
Or it can move between the toms and the cymbal. And one of the most common patterns that I like is.
I didn't know Memphis Drum Shop had their own, like, Remo toms. It's kind of cool. Unless they just put it on top.
And then if we add the bass drum.
I do kind of like grooves and like drummers who can really control everything. And they don't have to like, they don't have to like slam their drums. But they can just like get these really,
so
really awesome
this,
tones and shit.
Clarifies the
nice.
Notation
finally
and the sound, the way the hands move, the way the groove is supposed to feel. And I encourage you to check these things out. And I look forward to
ooh,
hearing
what is this? The user
how
swings.
You take these ideas and move them
it's
forward.
It's a strong, heavy fist. It lowers the user's speed, however.
In the year 2000, I spent some time working with Cameroonian bassist Richard Bona. Now, during my time with him, he introduced me to two rhythms. One's called Mangambe, and the other is called Bakutsi. Now, both these rhythms originate in his home country of Cameroon. And when he introduced me to these rhythms, I certainly had not heard them before. I had no knowledge of them, and I most definitely could not play them. So I had to develop a method to be able to interpret the information that he was giving me and put that in Western terms so that I could actually understand it. Let me explain the 3-4 polyrhythm, because that's the first thing that one must understand in order to be able to even begin to approach the music. So I'm going to tap the rhythm out on my chest. On my right hand, I'll be playing 4-4, or the quarter notes. And on my left hand, I'll play what I describe in the book as the long 3, which are basically a series of quarter note triplets on top of the 4-4 pulse. So this is what that rhythm sounds like. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. That's what the rhythm sounds like. That's what the polyrhythm is. Now, the trick with this is to learn to hear both sides of that rhythm happening at once. And I'm going to ask my good friend Jose Armando Gola on bass to join me so that we can demonstrate this information.
Well, I didn't notice they are going a bit more basic this year. Man, who does he look like? He looks like one of the guys, forgot his name, but there was a guy on Martin who used to wear like the cutoff, it's like a denim hoodie, just like that. Or not, yeah, I guess, but it didn't have the hood. I don't know what the fuck to call it, but it had like the strings hanging down and everything. Don't kill me.
Hey everyone.
Bitch.
I'm Brendan Buckley, and I'm here to show you my approach to double drumming. Let's first start with a foundational
like
groove. It could be something like this.
Or double bass.
Now we can add a second part to this. This second part we can call version A. In version A, we will be playing in unison with the foundational beat. We will have to match the timing and the feel of the other musicians. It's not too dissimilar from locking with a drum loop, where you're nailing the kicks and snares and not flamming. Okay, now we can try something else. This approach we'll call version B. With version B, we will treat it more like an overdub session at a recording studio. We can think in layers of subdivision or sonic frequency, highs, mids, lows. We can contrast,
talking about doing this for recording?
Long sounds and short sounds. Basically, think like a percussionist. Okay, now we're ready to try a third option. This option we can call version C.
Super.
In version C, we'll treat it more like a Latin rhythm section, where there are different parts going on at the same time, all locking together. You can ask yourself a question like, what's not there yet? Either rhythmically or sonically. You can air drum, beatbox, sing alternate parts in your head. This is counterpoint.
It's cool, he's got like all the fucking BBs on the bottom of his stand. He's got a little side stand.
Now I challenge you to get together with another drummer and experiment with these approaches. Keep in mind, you don't have to stick with just one. You can actually float in between all three. the playing in unison, thinking in layers of percussion, and the rhythmic counterpoint. Have fun.
I'll be real. I've done like really big like drum things before where there's like 10, 12 drummers, and that shit was so annoying. There's just so many people making so much noise and not playing like completely perfect in unison. This is cool though. Basically just doing percussion. This is like an instance where like double drumming can be cool. There's not like too many people playing shit and trying to like solo over each other. Oh, Todd Suterman. Actually, kind of an underrated drummer. Like, I don't hear enough people talking about him. He's like one of the few people that has a pretty big kit but actually uses everything in like a stylistic way, not just hitting shit to hit shit. he's got in ears inside his head, or like in his head, in his ears. Sounds like everything. Yeah, I was gonna say it sounds like everything is like pretty mashed up. Like I don't think he missed a fucking beat there. He's being pretty exact. Drums sound so good too. I mean, it's obviously been mixed, but everything just sounds so good. And he's got the fucking.
Time to announce the winner of the 2021 NeoPeart Spirit of Drumming Scholarship.
Splash symbol.
We received entries from all over the world for this very special scholarship that celebrates the life, music, and legend of NeoPeart. This year's winner will receive 52 weeks of free drum lessons from world-class drum instructor Dom Femularo, a one-year subscription to Modern Drummer All Access, plus a selection of classic Rush album releases, courtesy of Universal Music Enterprises. Selecting a winner from these entries was no easy task. The panel of judges included members of the Modern Drummer team, along with Don Femularo and myself, VP Head of A&R Universal Music Enterprises, and Modern Drummer Advisory Board member Dennis Wolfe. Dennis himself is a former recording and touring drummer and a lifelong Rush fan and a student of the drumming genius of NeoPeart. And of course, without whom this scholarship would not be possible, Carrie Nettle Peart, Neil's wife. Thank you, Carrie. This scholarship is absolutely incredible and we're so grateful for your support and to offer this scholarship to an up-and-coming inspired drummer. And that brings us to the moment we've all been waiting for. This year's winner of the NeoPeart Spirit of Drumming Scholarship Award. Is Max Rinkus. Congratulations, Max, and to all the entrants of this year's NeoPeart Spirit of Drumming Scholarship.
The next video you're about to see is a dream sequence. Modern Drummer publisher David Frangione and I, Rob Silverman, will be playing some of the most famous drum sets in Modern Drummer history. Some are famous because of who played them, and some are famous because of where and when they were played. In any case, it's a real dream come true. And to help you get in on the fun, Modern Drummer has set up a Drum Dreams contest page on their website. They've listed all of the drum kits that appear in this piece, and if you can list them all in the order that they appear in the video, you will be entered into a raffle to win this brand new, beautiful Yamaha snare drum.
What kind is it? It looks like a fucking cheap Stagecoach. David Frangione, Rob Silverman. Why are those videos not... like, what a weird montage. Would have been cool if they would have lined up like the audio. Like, aren't you supposed to like try to figure out the kits? not even like, you're showing like images of these guys. I don't give a fuck about these guys. God, I need to like edit these videos or something for them. Hit them up. Like, guys, I got you. You do better. They were literally like using effects from like the early 2000s. It's so funny. All these old like drummer guys are so weird. Don't follow the trend. Oh, here we go. To go to at least 70, then all I have to do is level bursary. Damn, there's a lot of drummers that died in 2021. It's kind of weird.
Hey, this is Tony Vertorosa, and I just want to give you a quick overview of how I map out all of the sounds using my MIDI controller and these Yamaha electronic drum pads triggers. So each one of these drum pads up here has three different zones.
It's close.
And one of the things that I love to do when I'm writing music is take advantage of something called alternate mode. So I can cycle through 7 or 12 or up to 100 different notes in the center of the drum. Right now I am triggering a Yamaha Montage keyboard, which is right over here. It's become one of the centerpieces for everything that I'm doing as a composer lately. So here's a small example of alternate mode.
Yeah, but he's just sponsored by Yamaha. Truth be told, their sounds are not even close to Roland's.
And there's
but I suppose
another
you can just program
really
your
useful
triggers,
function
I guess it really doesn't matter that much.
Called stack mode. And so I can just map out chord changes. For instance, right up here in the center of the drum, stack mode. And then a different chord on the rim. And we can apply alternate mode and stack mode to percussion sounds. You can apply it to cinematic drum sounds. And, you know, this has honestly been my life's work for a very long time. So I'm excited to share this with Modern Drummer. And let me just throw down a little jazz improv with this entire set of sounds. I hope you like it.
Kind of reminds me of like how Akira Jimbo used to do it. It is. This is just like how Akira Jimbo used to do it. time he hits like the bass drum in some of his songs, it triggers a chord to play. Cool.
Hey everybody, Eric Lederman here, producer of Late Night with Seth Meyers. Of course, I created the rotating drummer program. That's the only reason I'm here. That's my drum connection. That's why you're seeing me, as opposed to like, who is that? It's like, yeah, that's me. I want to introduce our next drummer. He's an incredible player. Always had amazing chops, and then he got on Instagram and blew it up. Now he's one of the busiest session players out there right now. Nick Baglio is an incredible musician. And you're all very lucky that he's gonna play for you right now. And he's got a very cute dog that he sends me pictures of all the time. It's like, hey man, just send me drum videos. Don't send me pictures of your dog, that's weird. Is it? I don't know. Everyone, Nick Baglio.
Pretty live. Snare sounds really, his main snare sounds good. I don't know how he's something to make it sound like that. I love that little fucking splash hi-hat. I think it's so sick. That like diffuser he's got behind him too. This shit's kinda sick. That one four thong literally like a Brendan Fraser Moore. What the fuck symbol is that? Is that Sabian? I don't know if I know that one. No, that's not Sabian. I don't know what kind of symbols those are. Can't hear that shit at all. We are going to switch gears. Kind of curious.
All right, here we go.
Hey guys, Luke Holland here. I did 6 songs on Polyphia's new upcoming record. I did a session here at Perfect Sound with Tim Henson. Clay and I essentially put our minds together. I'm very happy to be part of this album. Without further ado, enjoy the video.
This is the guy who needs to be on Modern Drummer.
We'll be right back.
That sounds cool. Everything super staccato. Gotta be like a super live room.
Good girl in a costume. It's your world when I'm with you. Forever with you like a tattoo. I paint a picture in a bad mood. She feel the breeze like a parachute. I got jeans, get a pair of shoes. Big body need a lot of room. She keep calling when I'm never home. I'll be what you need, low key on the east. I can see everything that you went through. I'll be your tool, I can fix you. Even if I lose, it'd be nothing new. She don't lose it, I'm hurt school. It's my rules when I make moves. I make it rain like a monsoon. My new baby, I'm soon. The best side was the best ride. She said that she really wanna come out to the west side. If she coming with me, she can hit me with her best side. She can be my missus, give me kisses on her best side. Low key, with me every night. You want me, but it's never right. Hold me, I'm a little.
I'm not sure how I feel about that snare drum, but I mean, whatever, I'm not gonna lose like a gig. Oh, bitch.
Alright.
Holy fuck, what's going on with my mouse? Luke Holland's so good at, like, taking kind of like a basic fill concept, but, like, blending it together to make it sound way more complicated than it is. Like, it's, I'm not even, like, that wasn't even, like, a back-end compliment. Like, that was just, like, he's just so good at, like, blending fills. Oh, like, that was cool. We kept like just like the left hand going. Like that, like right there. That wasn't super complicated, but that was like a really cool combination mixed in the song right then and there. And he did like a crossover, so it looked like crazier. I don't know, just really good style. I guess he just wants that crossover. Right hand, left hand. Still fucking gimped.
What's up, everyone? I'm Luke Holland, and these are the cymbals that you just saw me play. Pure Alloy 14-inch medium hi-hats, Byzance 10-inch dual splash, Byzance 18-inch traditional medium thin crash, Artist Concept.
Oh, this is gonna be cool, I bet.
One, two, three, four.
It was on Jam Card. Else is just like so calm and like like chilling. Matt McGuire was in the back just like fucking hopping around like crazy. Show him playing at all? What the fuck's going on here? That's kind of weird. That's kind of cool. Show him at all. What the fuck's going on here? This is like more Chainsmoker branding, and they just don't really want to focus too hard on that. Got the jazz flute. Like, they don't show Matt McGuire at all in this shit. I mean, this is probably pretty cool to like just listen to. General, but that's not what the fuck. Why are these not working? I think YouTube's fucked a little bit. Oh, he does fucking. Mm-hmm. Nookie. This is going to be good. This has got to be good. How basic this song is. Is actually like incredible. This kind of is not his best performance, and like it's funny you mentioned like the camera angle, because I was actually I didn't say anything yet, but like this is kind of the style that made him popular. It was like, instead of having, because a lot of drummers, what they'll try to do when they're filming like drum covers and stuff, each one will try to find like some kind of like unique like angle that no one else uses. And he, like, his was unique back in the day because he had someone who was just holding it and fucking moving the entire time, but not like this. This one, like, feels like more rigid. I don't know why. I don't know if the guy's got like a peg leg today or something, or what the fuck. But like, Matt McGuire's like really good. He did like, let me see if I can find like a, let's do this. Let's go. There's like, he does like a, this one's really good. This Marshmallow cover. Like this shit's really good. And I feel like I've seen a couple of videos from him lately where he doesn't go as hard. Maybe he just doesn't have enough time to like work on him or something. I'm not quite sure. These were shot in 720p back in the day. Did you send one to me? If you sent it to me, I know I watched it. Let me go into Discord. If you post it, I can watch it. Yeah, but notice how, like, the cameraman isn't, like, super annoying here. He's not, like, fucking, like, jittering and shit. It's like, yeah, there's movement, but it's not, like... Like, that's really hard, that fucking one-handed roll like that. And he's, like, adding more to the songs and stuff, too. Like, all that shit was, like, super, like, intricate. I'm like 100% positive. This guy's good though. He does like, he does the rim shot, like one-handed roll. Yeah, this is a really popular video. What's going on with my mouse? Yeah, 2.2 million views, okay. It was what I thought it was. He uses like the backs of his sticks and shit too. That's like the one thing I've never understood. I 100% know the difference between using the back of your stick and not, and I don't see any benefit of using the back of your stick. I feel like it's like a vanity thing that people just commit to. No clue why they do it. Like, they actually sell drumsticks that don't even have, like, a tip. They're basically just, like, actual, like little mini logs. I got that same top I had, though. And splash. And, no, I don't see that. Got really good doubles on his feet. I'm almost positive in the mix they trigger these. Like, that's why all those snare drum hits, like, if we go back, like those, they're all one solid sound. Actually, you know what? Now that I think about it, I think he just might have just played to the track, but
No, I think that back. No, he must have just triggered the snare drum then. Yeah, see, now it's not. These are way different sounds than what he had there for those last beats. Yeah. Even that, like, that resonant sound that came out of the snare just there. Still a good drummer, though. I'm going to talk about Limp Bizkit. I don't know if I ever showed you this, Freak. This shit's hilarious. Where the fuck's it at? This shit's hilarious.
All right, partner.
It's like this Japanese metal band.
Keep on rolling.
This is an
baby.
Old video. This is like 8 years ago.
You know what time it is.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chuck is selfish.
I think these guys were like fucking real young whenever they did this. It's so funny. It's actually kind of heavy though. Their drummer's really good though. Dude, wait, do you know this band? Dude, so, get this shit. So, my band's in the studio recording right now, and Ryo apparently just quit. Something about like his mental health isn't right. And a buddy of the engineer who's recording us, I guess made it to the finals of their tryouts. So I guess the next step is he has to like fly to Japan and do like the last set of tryouts to see if he becomes the new vocalist for this band. And yeah, actually Apollo's pretty sick too. Let me go back. Yeah, I actually like Apollo. It's pretty sick how they like, well, I guess it makes sense, right? They're from Japan. But I like, there's a more Asian-esque scale called the Hirajoshi scale. They use a lot of that. At least I think they do. If memory serves. Yeah, see, their drummer though, the one thing is like when you watch his shit live, he does like, his hits are all super heavy. He has no trigger. It does suck that like their vocalist is like gone now. I really liked him. I think he's definitely like a big part of like what made this band successful. Like, he was a really good front man. Dude, you know what's funny? Like, I would play like hardcore and stuff, but I liked things like Slayer and shit like that, but a lot of metal kind of pushed me away when I was like younger, because I just hated blast beats. I'm right there with you. Like, that shit gets so boring, or like some of the really easy breakdowns. There's only so much of that I can just like, that specific genre of metal I can listen to. Yeah, a lot of modern metal is like way more sophisticated, 100%. There's a lot of bands out there like Chelsea Green, I would say, where like the drummer kind of holds that band together a little bit more. Because like sometimes the guitars really don't do very much. And that can kind of be, I don't know, I can kind of get tired of that too. But I always like how bands from like other countries, because I mean this is like a Western influence for sure. I always find it like interesting how bands from other countries like put their take on that genre, or a genre that's more Western.
A lot of kids that grew up cradle filled. Sounds like you and something the same.
Cradle of Filth. It's so funny. I was never that big into them, but I knew people who were. That's so funny. I couldn't even tell you the last time I listened to them. The cool thing is with this band though is like they 100% have like that, like they have to have like some of that hardcore influence. Like some of like, even like the way the guitar players are like kind of like dancing, it, there's like a very particular style like, that comes from like hardcore with that. And I really like, there's a style of writing that does come from hardcore, in which case like you know how to like make songs be more full, and like there are certain ways of like building things up and transitioning them. Like I can hear it in all genres, any from like pop punk to like metal to like even this stuff, which is slightly like a hybrid, right, where he's like singing. It's really cool. I really like these guys, and I hope they're able to kind of like move forward with the new vocalist, because I really think this guy did like a really good job. I mean, they were fucking so successful. They have like millions of views, right? This one has 6.6 million. Like, all their shit has millions. That one almost 2 million. Well, that's interesting. That one only has like 700K. Yeah, 1.3 million. That one has 900K. Okay, maybe not all of them. But yeah, 1.6, 1.7, almost 900, 1.7. I mean, what is it? The joke video they did for, that's got 3.1 million. I mean, they're a super successful band. Let's talk about Pantera. Pantera was terrible. I don't even know. That might be a video for another day. Pantera wasn't all terrible. They might have been racist, but they weren't all terrible. Watch Me Burn is good. Dude, my mouse is triggering the fuck out of me. I don't know what is going on, but I feel like it needs a charge. Anyways, Freak, I wish you would have said something earlier. You caught me at the end, man. I'm tired as fuck. I've been having to go to like fucking a bunch of different like doctor's appointments and shit because I'm trying to get this shit recovered. And work's kind of been crazy too. Oh yeah, I think I told you I was like taking an extra class because my degree got like I found out when I just went to grab the piece of paper that I got fucked over by the school, so I actually ended up having to take a class. So that's been kind of a pain in the ass, but the class is almost done, so eventually I can be a degenerate again, just like the good old days. Which I can't wait. I think I'm going to hop off for the night because I'm tired as actual fuck. I hope you've been well, dude. It's been a while since we've talked. We'll have to hang one of these nights. Like I said, I hope you've been well. I hope that new... I think it was last time we talked. It's because it's been a while now. Hope everything's going well with, I want to say, the new job. Or the... Well, I guess it's not maybe not new now. It's been a while. But hope everything's been going well. Like I said... I'm gonna hop off. I'll chat with you later. Peace, bro.